Scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah 9, 2-7 from the New Living Translation. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. You will enlarge the nation of Israel, and its people will rejoice. They will rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest and like warriors dividing the plunder. For you will break the yoke of their slavery and lift the heavy burden from their shoulders. You will break the oppressor's rod, just as you did when you destroyed the army of Midian. The boots of the warrior and the uniforms bloodstained by war will all be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. May God add his blessing to his word.
When I announced the singing of Join the Angels, I said, this is the last time. But I just looked at the schedule for tonight, and it's not. I can sing tonight again. I just loved the rhythm and the beat and the message of that carol. And I heard it on the way to Banff. My sister was in the car, and she said, here, this is what we're going to play on our float in Dauphin. And I really liked it, and I said, I think I could use that. And as I looked at that carol and looked at the message, whether Matthew West is the band that played it, and whether it was Matthew that put it together in terms of organizing which verses and stuff, I liked the idea that he started off with, the Lord is come. And the second verse, I preached on that phrase, the Lord is come, and that presence, the idea that time, the way we think of it, just doesn't work. So whether it was a grammatical thing, whether it was Old English to say the Lord is come or the Lord has come, I messed with that a little bit and just drove it home that he is here now, as Alfred said. But he has come to the earth, and he's coming again. And that's a wonderful message of that. The Lord has come, joy to the world. And then in the second verse of Matthew West's carol, Join the Angels, he pointed out that life isn't nice. There's all kinds of bad things that happen. And you need to take your burdens, and because of that Jesus came to this earth, that God loves us, it's in control, that we can lay down our burdens. Lay it down was the theme of that. And then last week, with the children's play, and it just drove home the idea that we need to believe. And lots of scripture was read, and the kids made their funny little skits, but all driving home the idea that we need to accept the gift of Jesus, the gift from God, and we need to do it by believing on him. And then Matthew West chose to finish off that carol by reciting this scripture, Isaiah 9, that we had read for us this morning, and then he also added, and you might pay attention to this tonight when you sing it, that he goes from Isaiah 6 right into Philippians 2, where at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. This isn't just a story. Our celebrating Christmas isn't just saying, well, something happened really neat 2,000 years ago. A baby was born. And we don't even have a manger out here. And the manger we have at the back doesn't have a baby in it. Somebody should fix that tonight or something. But we're not just celebrating that. We're celebrating an absolute, incredible change for all mankind that God announced through Isaiah to a hopeless world. They were in trouble. And he does it. We're going to look at this passage and recognize that when Matthew West, a musician, was working on his song and Join the Angels and the nice chorus and stuff, he might have been having in the back of his head Handel's Messiah, the Handel's chorus work, if you want to know a neat way to get ready to hear a sermon on Isaiah 9, turn that on and have the great choir sing it. I had it on yesterday and had it really loud. And I said, that's what I'm preaching on tomorrow. And repeats it over and over again. And actually, instead of four titles, it makes five. Because it's wonderful and counselor. And you know, just look up that this afternoon. Handel's Messiah style, Handel's style is a bit different from Matthew West, but it ends up with the same major theme and title that I want to look at this morning. The Prince of Peace, the Messiah. We're waiting for Jesus. We're waiting for the celebration time that we've set aside for a special day off and sharing presents and all that. And, well, Advent has come, the Messiah has come, and Isaiah claimed him as the Prince of Peace. We'll just leave that off for now, Lori, in case they try to read it. Thank you. The Prince of Peace, an incredible title. And Isaiah was, that chapter in Isaiah follows a second prophecy, because Isaiah was a prophet. He took the words that God gave him, and he declared them to the people. And the one just before this one came true already. Like right then, the people knew Isaiah had prophesied, and then it came true. And it was a miserable one. The Assyrians included their enemies and their people dying and all kinds of stuff. And there was no hope. Isaiah's prophecies were powerful. He spoke for God, and he got their attention when those kind of prophecies came true. But in the midst of their lives, in the context of that time in history, when Isaiah was working with these people who said they were believers in God, but disobeyed him time and time again, went off on their own, and they had to be told by God, you're going to get it, and they got it, and they were miserable. Lots of pain and confusion and fear. And then Isaiah comes up, or God gives this message through Isaiah, the message of hope. For unto you a child is born, unto you a child is given. What a wonderful message of hope. Time of pain and tough confusion and fear in their lives. It wouldn't take us very much serious thought to admit that that's where we are now. Even with all the stuff we got, all the opportunities we have, fear seems to be driving so many people. Driving them to confusion, driving them to go with crazy ideas. Whether it's fear or whether it's plain pain, there's so much pain when people are confused and frightened. So many broken hearts, broken relationships, broken bodies. We're in a time of that kind of pain. We're in the kind of time of confusion and fear. So when we listen to this message from God through Isaiah to the people, it's a message of hope. There's no better time for it. For them, it was a very timely message. A child is coming, and he'll be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And his government and its peace will never end. He starts off after, in verse 1, there's some directions. We talked about the last prophecy and this some big names in it. Verse 2, he says, the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, guess what? A light's going to shine. So when we sense and feel the depression and the stress of our lives and the confusion of where we turn, all you have to do is say it a few times and it becomes true whether it has any truth or not. We're in those times. There's a darkness. Yet, Christmas time comes along and every city that's worth its week we'll have a festival of lights. And some cities do it better than others. And some people in town here do it better than others. And I was hoping that our Lisa would be here this morning and I could make a comment about how wonderful her husband and her do their house. Lots of lights. Just go over there in that neighborhood and turn your radio on and you'll hear it. Oh, it's wonderful lights. We want light because darkness brings pain. We love lights. But when Isaiah said, prophesied that Jesus was coming and he'd be the light of the world and the people who walk in darkness will see a great light, it wasn't just symbolic. Because we know that darkness hurts. Dark times when evil rules cause hurt and pain. But Jesus, the light of the world, is deeply needed. Have you listened this year as I drew your attention to the first chapter of John, that in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God and the Word was God. It's talking about baby Jesus, if you wish. In the beginning, Jesus has come into our neighborhood and into our lives. That's why we celebrate. That's why we gather together. That's why we tell our children. That's why we spend time in the Word of God, because He saved us and given us eternal life and a relationship with Him. That's the great light. The light brings wisdom, vision, and most of all, an awareness that God is in control. And we need to be told that over and over and over again. The people that Isaiah was talking to, they particularly needed to hear that God was in control. He was on their side. But we need to hear that and hear it in the deepest part of our being when we're quiet, when we're uptight. Spinning. When you settle down, remember that God is in control. Light brings vision. The light of the world brings a clearer way of looking at the world and gives us a wisdom about what's going on in the world, in the storms and the troubles in our life. Our response is different from those that don't know Jesus. We don't have the light. We haven't experienced. For them who walk in darkness, they'll see a great light, and there's who live in the land of darkness, a light will shine. I trust that this Christmas you've already experienced a fresh way of Jesus, the light of the world, shining in your life, helping you settle in and let go of some of the problems that are coming at you all the time. Say, Lord's going to solve those. I don't need to do that. Then God gives Isaiah the wonderful words that ring loud in your ears if you listen to Handel's song. Lots. For unto us a child is born, a child is given, a son is given, the government being on his shoulders. And then he seems to give some titles. And the wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. They seem like kind of strange titles for a Messiah, for Jesus. And I'm not going to try to preach on each one of those. In fact, I want to skip over them a little bit. I just jump to the one that fits nicest, the Emmanuel thing. Jesus was to name, Joseph was to, and Mary were to name Jesus that name, and it means Emmanuel, God with us. The people hearing Isaiah's prophecy wouldn't have missed that, though. That's what they would have heard, that God is with us. It's God that's speaking through Isaiah, saying he's going to give us a hope in his son, Jesus. Emmanuel fits better, God with us. Commentators always have something interesting to say, and when I looked it up, and I found that this sentence was something I wanted to share with you. It seems best to see these titles as all matching in translated form. They all go together. Isaiah does not mean that the child will actually bear these names, but they are descriptive of who he is. And like I say, I could preach on each one of these as a title of a section of my sermon, A Wonderful Counselor, A Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. God's words for Isaiah to share were clearly to bring hope and reassurance that God was there for them, that he would give Jesus to the world. But I want to talk more about the last one, the Prince of Peace. The same commentary said that the beautiful title Prince of Peace reflects the nature of his rule, which will bring a cessation of warfare and a wholeness to society, an idea included in the Hebrew word that's translated peace. The end of warfare and a wholeness to society. In fact, the message when he translates it, Eugene Peterson translates the titles, he says his names will be Amazing Counselor, Strong God, Eternal Father, Prince of Wholeness. He doesn't even say peace. Wholeness and peace. When we think of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, what does he mean? What did God mean when he told Isaiah that would bring hope? That another ruler would come along, instead of Prince of Warfare, he'd be one that would be a Prince of Peace. Well, we're going to look at that, see what Jesus meant by that. But now first I want to read a quote from an evangelist who died in 1951, but he had, by the time he moved to California with his mom and brothers, and in the century, and he was only 11, and there was no Sunday school where they were, so he and his buddies gathered a whole bunch of burlap around, and they made a tent, and there was nobody to preach, so he started preaching. And he preached, became a famous preacher. His name's Harry Ironside, and he says this: the Prince of Peace. As such, he was presented to the world and heralded by the angels in Luke 2. But because of his rejection, there can be no lasting peace for Israel or the nations until he comes again. Then he will be manifested as the one who will speak peace to all peoples. Meantime, having made peace by the blood of his cross, all who put their trust in him have peace with God. And as we learn to commit all that would naturally trouble or distress, commit all that to God in prayer, peace fills our hearts and controls our lives. Did you get that? Now we can talk about it. We can talk about the title that was given by God to the promised Messiah, the Prince of Peace. How the people waited, the Israelites waited year after year, century after century, for the Messiah to come, and they knew that he would be called the Prince of Peace. What we do with that is that we need to realize that we can have a personal relationship with that Jesus, with that Messiah, and it changes us. It peace fills our hearts and controls our lives. The baby grew. The promise fulfilled for eternity. Jesus, the Prince of Peace. But Jesus' definition of peace was a whole lot more than just the absence of war. I want us to look at some of Jesus' definitions. Laura, you put that first one up. We've already talked about this season when we talked about lay your burden down. The words of Jesus, he asks his disciples and he asks us, he says, are you tired? You worn out? Burned out on religion? And I added the part, or Christmas preparation. Does it burn you out? Jesus said, come to me. Get away with me. And you'll recover your life. Okay, remember, we're looking at how Jesus defined peace. Getting away. Recovering your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. This is where, if you're already notes, you would write down definitions of Jesus' definitions of peace. You would put down unforced rhythms of grace so that you could ponder that later. Because that's a heavy one. Unforced rhythms of God's grace in your life so that you sense his power. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you, Jesus said. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Wow. Jesus' definition. The next one is from Matthew 5:9. Jesus said, you're blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. Okay, we're talking about Jesus' definition of peace. He's the Prince of Peace. And he says, you're going to feel blessed when you, because of your relationship with me, can show people how to cooperate instead of fight or compete. Okay, that's a lot of work. That's a whole different worldview, a whole different attitude that you need to take. Even the, can you imagine, we had some hockey coaches here, and they were trying to figure out how to take their walk with Jesus and their understanding of Jesus' definition of peace and apply it to the competition and the fight of you gotta win or you didn't play, or it's not worth playing if you don't win, and all those kinds of things. Well, what if he was to take it the other way and actually teach the children that the idea of playing is for the sake of the enjoyment of being able to participate at your full strength, win or lose? Jesus says you'll be blessed if you act and understand life that way, that you can enter into people's lives and help them to get along. That it isn't one big fight. It isn't who carrying the biggest stick or who's standing last. That's not life. That's Jesus' definition of peace. Because he says, and that's when you discover who you really are. When you can share that kind of view of life, of cooperation, you'll discover who you really are and your place in God's family. These are the words of the baby Jesus, except he wasn't a baby anymore. He was grown up. But he was the one that God sent. Then from Matthew 6. Here's what I want you to do, Jesus said. Now he was talking to his disciples, and I hope that you are okay with this idea that you're one of Jesus' disciples, and that you don't get to just read this history saying, oh, that was nice that he said it to them. He's saying it to you and I this morning. Every time you open the Word of God, that's what's really happening in us. We need to take it that way. And so Jesus says to you and I, this is what I want you to do. Remember, we're thinking of what was Jesus' definition of peace. He says, find a quiet, secluded place. Huh. Yeah. For everybody but young mothers, there's no place in the world, is there? Well, apparently the bathroom, you lock the door. But I heard that from my daughter. Find a quiet, secluded place. Why? So you won't be tempted to role play before God. Oh, I thought that the reason for being in a quiet, secluded place was that nobody would pester you and yelling, I need this, I need that. Could you please go and go? All that stuff that happens when you're not in a secluded place. But Jesus had something else in mind in his definition of peace. Remember, it's peace with God. Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and in our relation gives us a relationship of peace with our eternal Father. And there's that all messy thing about sin and him having to die for our, to defeat Satan and our sins and all that stuff, and we are in our belief that we're forgiven. But Jesus says, find a secluded place so that you won't be tempted to role play before God. It's always uncomfortable when you read the scriptures I make a big deal that it's Jesus talking to you and I, and then it comes out so pointed. And almost, well, I don't know about you, but I'm not very comfortable with the idea that somebody thinks I'm going to be role-playing with God. Or at least I'm more uncomfortable with the idea that I caught. Because we all do it. We do it with one another. We can't put on a brave face. How are you doing today? And if you haven't got the time, or maybe you just don't want anybody to know because you don't want to trust them with your hurt, you just say fine and move on. But we do it with the God too. We get our Bible out. We're going to start our devotions. And as plain as can be, we hear God saying this, how are you doing? I'm having my devotions. Why? Leave me alone. Or, of course I'm doing fine. I'm having my devotions. You know, God, that how good I am. I'm having my time with you. Well, that would be role-playing. Jesus says, go away quiet. Not just the external noise, but the internal noise. That's the peace that Jesus can give. That internal noise that Satan keeps yelling at us in our ears. And he says, just be there. In that secluded place. Get away by yourself and just be there. And he says, as simply and honestly as you can imagine. Okay, to get anywhere near that, I can imagine myself sitting there, or standing there, having to get simply and honestly, having to go about 10 times. If I did that now, I'd fall asleep. But that's what Jesus was saying. So something has to happen. As a result of you believing in me, that you can get off by yourself and be honest and simple with God. And then he, listen, can you imagine that? I just don't know if the disciples would have got it this way, but I wonder if we can. He says, the focus will shift when we're doing this, when we're in a secluded place, we're going simply and honestly, not role playing before God. He says, the focus will shift from you to God. Can you imagine? You won't be thinking, Lord, I need this, I need this, I need this. Can you help me do this? And my friends, can you? It actually might shift to saying, thank you, God. Thank you for who you are. And you will begin to sense his grace and his love. Jesus had a completely different definition of peace than we carry. Can we handle that? Paul understood Jesus' definition of peace. So in his letters, the one he wrote to Galatians, to the Galatians, he describes how the Prince of Peace changes everything. He says, but what happens when we live God's way? What happens when we accept Jesus as the Prince of Peace into our lives? That's what he's asking the Christians in Galatia. And he says, he, Jesus, the Prince of Peace, brings gifts into our lives in much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. And listen, these could be like definitions of peace from that Paul has understood from Jesus. He says, he gives gifts, same way that fruit appears in the orchard. Things like affection for others. Got that gift? Not thinking about yourself first. Actually liking others. Exuberance about life. Serenity. Looking for definition of peace. Again, take a deep breath. Paul says we develop a willingness to stick with things. I could preach on that one for a long time about quitting is too soon. Giving up. He says, a sense of compassion in the heart. We actually learn to hear people's stories and love them in their pain. And not just think about, oh, that reminds me of how much I hurt one time. That's not a compassionate heart, but it's a gift that Jesus gives to us. A sense of compassion in the heart. And a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. Oh, what a mouthful that is. Have you got a basic conviction of anything? What on earth could you have a... Why would you bother even trying to make this one happen? Do you actually believe that there's a basic holiness that's in people and things? That God is alive, that he's in control, and he's in people's lives? Well, that has to come as a gift, because we're more cynical. How about this? I'm usually more cynical than that. This is a hard one for me. You need to be careful. You wouldn't tell your kids to go out in the world and not duck once in a while and not look before they cross the street or anything like that. You tell them, be careful. It's dangerous out there. There's people out there. Evil is going to get you. You live your life that way. It's so easy. And sometimes we think that it's pretty important. Well, there is wisdom involved in all these things. But Paul says you need to, it's a gift. Like fruit in an orchard. It's a gift that you have the conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. Then he says, we find ourselves involved in loyal commitments. Wow, that is a gift. Being friends with somebody, being a good relative to somebody, can we describe that as a loyal commitment? Not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. These are results of the peace from the Prince of Peace, Jesus. Then finally, Paul writes in Colossians 15, 3, I think it is. He says, let the peace of Christ, Paul knew Jesus. We don't know, but he heard all the stories of Jesus from Luke and so many of the others. And we believe that miraculously Paul had a relationship with Jesus that we don't understand in terms of his understanding. The things that Paul, how he was changed, it was only Jesus, and he understood the peace. And so he says, let the peace of Christ, he's talking about this Prince of Peace from the prophecy of Isaiah, from our Christmas preparations, the Prince of Peace. He says, let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. This is wonderful that we understand that we have a relationship with God, a peaceful relationship with God, because God no longer sees our sin because of Christ. That's great. But if we miss the point, if we stop there, we have missed the point. Paul's driving it home here. He says, when you let this Prince of Peace affect your life in the way we've talked, you will keep your relationship with others in tune. You'll be in step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. He says, and cultivate thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house. Who's making the decisions? Who has the run of your house? Have you trusted God, trusted Christ, the Prince of Peace, to do that? Paul writes, give it plenty of room in your lives. That's the word of Christ, the word of the Bible. What the Bible teaches, give it plenty of room in your life. Don't just put it off to Sunday morning once in a while. Or when you finally get around to having your devotion, he says, give it plenty of room in your lives. Instruct and direct one another using good common sense. Remember, he's talking to a group of people, and he says, this is how you should do it. Sing and sing your hearts out to God. Let every detail in your lives, your words, your action, whatever, be done in the name of the Master Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. Let every detail in your lives, words, actions, be done in the name of the Master Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son Jesus. We thank you for this special time of year when we can focus and have help in focusing on your Son Jesus from the culture, the celebrating Christmas, having a holiday from work, having our friends and neighbors put up lights to get rid of the darkness, having our friends and neighbors buy things for people and give gifts. But we know that the best gift, Jesus, the Prince of Peace, needs to be accepted too for to understand fully and let us live and putting you first in our lives. Help us with that, Heavenly Father. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.